Okay, so as a law student, I thought it'd be interesting to know how do you differentiate between the traditions or laws in Indian religions to the laws of the land and the countries?
Okay, you see, what about the codes of conduct that we adopt in any society, religious as well as secular society? The codes of conduct are the rules that by which society can operates. The rules by which a family operates, how do family members relate to each other, how do families relate to the greater community, how does the greater community relate to the greater society like that. It's very important to explore these things. Now, you require some kind of guidelines and rules for any society to operate efficiently. It's very understandable. Now, in the ancient times, the Hindus produced a lot of these kind of so-called shastras, if you like, injunctions, which they imposed, or the law book they imposed on the people, saying you must follow this particular format for you to be to for you to lead a, if you like, an ethical or moral life. But all these shastras, all these particular kind of injunctions, came with a health warning right at the start. He said the laws that you conform to now are if you like, not set in stone. As society continues to evolve, these laws must evolve to take into account the changing needs of a society. They're not set in stone. Thankfully, they're not set in stone. As society evolves, some of the issues that you thought were moral may be considered to be not moral anymore. And something which you thought were immoral may be considered to be acceptable now. So society, in a way, as it continues to evolve, it requires that this kind of laws that you impose on its people should continue to evolve and change. They should not be fixed in, they are not set in. This is a wonderful thing. I'll give one example. The ancient Hindu text, which was the codes of conduct used by Hindus for about 1,000 years, is called Manusmriti. It's a real, if I'm warning the Hindus today, if you read the Manusmriti today, you'll really shudder. You won't believe this is your religious injunction of how society should operate. You will not believe what is written in the Manusmriti today. Just give you one example. In the Manusmriti, say if you are a lower caste Hindu, and if by mistake you hear the slokas of the Vedas, the sacred scriptures, oh dear, you committed a major sin and will pour molten metal in your ears. I say, you used to do things like that. This was the law book. This was the law book of ancient Hindus. So you can see it is really outdated, and thankfully, as we recognize that the sell-by date is gone, no Hindu, as far as I know, is prepared to now, keep a Manusmriti in their homes. So fortunately, it's gone. So the law books must continue to evolve and take into account the changing needs of society. One of the best things the Hindus say is this: if you live in a country where they've got their own laws, you must try and participate and in a way sit well with the laws. Don't break the laws of the country you live in, because you're going against, if you like, the grain of that particular nation. So you must kind of, I'm not saying give up all your own principles, basically follow a certain system that you kind of adopted because you live in a country, so you must adopt the laws, the secular laws of that nation, without imposing it, saying that this is, I've got freedom. You don't have that freedom. You must participate in the greater world and agree with the society, the laws the society imposes on you. So the secular laws should be followed according to the Hindu tradition. Nothing wrong with that. As I said, again, just as I warned about the Smriti scriptures, the legendary stories, take them with a pinch of salt. Don't just take them as literal truth, otherwise you'll have a problem. I'm saying the same thing. Some of the Shastric injunctions that were given are really seriously outdated and counterproductive for the greater good. In the ancient times, they said, oh, a young girl, when she's very young, she's under the charge of her father. The father dictates what the little girl can do. And when she's married, the husband decides how she should lead her life. And when she becomes a widow, the son decides what she should do. The women were given no rights whatsoever. They're considered to be secondary. You can see the world that we live in, no woman is going to tolerate this kind of injunctions. For the Shastras.